Well, welcome and good morning. We're so glad you're here to join us on this beautiful Lord's Day. It is beautiful indeed. God is good and He has blessed us with so much. We welcome you to stand if you can for the reading of God's Word. We're going to open with Ecclesiastes 6. There is an evil which I have seen under the sun, and it is prevalent amongst men. A man to whom God gives riches and wealth and honor, so that his soul lacks nothing of all that he desires. Yet God does not empower him to eat from them, for a foreigner eats from him. This is vanity and a sickening evil. If a man becomes a father of 100 children and lives many years, however many the days of his years may be, but his soul is not satisfied with good things, and he does not even have a proper burial, then I say, better the miscarriage than he, for that one comes in vanity and goes in darkness, but that one's name is covered in darkness. Indeed, that one never sees the sun and never knows anything. That one has more rest than he. Even if the other man lives 1,000 years twice and does not see good things, do not all go to the same place? All a man's labor is for his mouth, and yet the soul is not fulfilled. What advantage does the wise man have over a fool? What advantage does the afflicted man have, knowing how to walk before the living? What the eyes see is better than what the soul goes after. This too is vanity and striving after wind. Whatever exists has already been named, and it is known. What man is. He cannot dispute with him who is stronger than he is. For there are many words which increase vanity. What then is the advantage to a man? For who knows what is good for a man during his lifetime, during the few days of his vain life? He will make do with them like a shadow. For who can tell a man what he will be, what will be after him under the sun? Glory to Heavenly Father, we are so thankful that you alone know what will come after the sun, Lord. That you have foreordained all things, you number our days, Lord. That you alone are where every good gift comes from, Lord. That we just pray that we would never take your many blessings for granted. That we would always receive them with due thanks and reverence, Lord. That we just pray that we would always be as close as possible to the praise and glory and worship that you deserve, Lord. We just pray for the service. Pray that the music would be uplifting and glorifying to you. That all the words would be truth in line with what you would have us to know. Lord, that we would take your truth home and, Lord, keep it in our hearts, but also shine it through in our daily lives. We just pray that you would be made more, you would be made higher, and that your church would grow in line with your will. Pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. All right. How great thou art.
O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the works thy hand hath made, I see the stars, I hear the mighty thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to me, how great thou art, how great thou art. My soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. When through the woods and forest glades I wander and hear the birds in the look down from lofty mountain grandeur and hear the brook and feel the gentle breeze. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. And when I think that God, his Son not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in. That on the cross, my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and lead me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, thee. How great thou art, how great thou art.
All right. Amen, amen. Ooh. Well, good morning. A beautiful morning out there. We want to welcome you here this morning. And those that are online watching, we want to welcome you also. Our scripture reading this morning is going to come out of Romans 1 through 17, so you can prepare for that. Just one announcement this morning. On the 26th, Saturday the 26th, we have Here We Stand. It's a workshop that's at our sister church in La Grande. And there's a handout that we've had in the bulletin, and then out on in the narthex there's one. Under the what we're to bring, Athena Baptist Church is asked to bring salads. It has other things listed there, but just salads for us. So if you're planning on going, we can also talk about carpooling. So whatever, whoever, just let us know. We'll work things out. So looking forward to that time that we can get together with a sister church and have this workshop. So, yeah, we're looking forward to that. So let's just take a time of silence and before God's word is read. Paul, a slave of Christ Jesus, called as an apostle, having been set apart for the gospel of God, which he promised beforehand through his prophets in the Holy Scriptures concerning his Son, who was born of the seed of David according to the flesh, who was designated as the Son of God in power according to the Spirit of holiness by the resurrection from the dead, Jesus Christ our Lord, through whom we receive grace and apostleship for the obedience of faith among all the Gentiles for the sake of his name, among whom you also are the called of Jesus Christ, to all who are beloved of God in Rome, called as saints, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. First, I thank my God through Jesus Christ for you all, because your faith is being proclaimed throughout all the whole world. For God, whom I serve in my spirit in the gospel of his Son, is my witness as to how, without ceasing, I make mention of you, always in my prayers, earnestly asking if perhaps now, at last, by the will of God, I may succeed in coming to you. For I long to see you so that I may impart some spiritual gifts to you that you may be strengthened, that is, to be mutually encouraged while among you by each other's faith, both yours and mine. I do not want you to be unaware, brothers, that often I have planned to come to you and have been prevented so far, so that I may have some fruit among you also, even as among the rest of the Gentiles. I am under obligation both to Greeks and to barbarians, both to the wise and to the foolish. In this way, for my part, I am eager to proclaim the gospel to you also who are in Rome. For I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes, to the Jew first, also to the Greek. For in it the righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, but the righteous will live by faith. Blessed assurance.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God. Born of his Spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, perfect delight, visions of rapture now burst on my sight. Angels descending, ring from above, echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, all is at rest. I and my Savior am happy and blessed, watching and waiting, looking above, filled with his goodness, lost in his love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. My shepherd I'll not want. He makes me lie in pastures green. He leads me by the still waters. His goodness restores my soul, and I will trust in you alone, and I will trust in you alone. For your endless mercy follows me, your goodness will lead me home. He guides my ways in righteousness, and he anoints my head with oil, and my cup it overflows with joy. I feast on his pure delights, and I will trust in you. And I will trust in you alone. For your endless mercy follows me, your goodness will lead me home. And though I walk the darkest path, I will not fear the evil one, for you are with me, and your rod and staff are the comfort I need to know. And I will trust in you alone. And I will trust in you alone. For your endless mercy follows me, your goodness will lead me home. For your endless mercy follows me, your goodness will lead me home.
Look forward to that day.
God Almighty, in three persons, blessed Trinity. Holy, 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 all the saints adore thee, casting down their golden crowns around the glassy sea. Cherubim and seraphim falling down before thee. Who was then, are then, evermore shall be. Holy, 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 though the darkness hide thee, though the eye of sinful man thy glory may not see, only thou art holy, there is none beside thee. Perfect in power, in love and purity. Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, all thy works shall praise thy name in earth and sky and sea. Holy, 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 merciful and mighty, God in three persons, blessed Trinity.
Amen.
Amen. That is our subject today as well. Well, good morning, beloved. It's good to see each one of you here. It's good to be in the house of the Lord. And we are so blessed to be together. And today we'll start our new study in the book of Acts. And so it's an exciting time for us. Well, today the message is the introduction to the book of Acts. And let us pray together as we seek God's face and as we humbly go before his throne and ask him by the power of his Holy Spirit that he would teach us the things we need to know. So, Father, we thank you. We're here to worship you. You are holy. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And Father, we thank you that you are above all, and there is no one like you, and we praise you for that, Father. We thank you for the work you're doing in your church, not only here in Athena, but throughout the world. And we raise world missions to you today and pray for those that are out preaching the gospel. Father, that you would have your way. And your perfect will would be made known. Be with us now, and as we now read your word, and as we discover new things, blessed Holy Spirit, we ask now that you would come and illuminate your word to us and teach us. And we're so thankful for the work that you're doing in the world that we live in. Thank you for being the restraining power. And if it wasn't for you, this place would be 10 times, 100 times, 1,000 times more evil than it is today. But you restrain that, and we thank you for that. Thank you for protecting us as well, for each one of your, each one of the Christians, Father. And so we give this all to you and ask now that you would receive our worship. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, you're probably wondering, we talked about Acts, and you're probably wondering, well, we're in John. this morning, well, the whole message is about the Holy Spirit today. And so, and the promise, and we'll see that in the scripture as well, and next week we'll be looking into these things as well. But in John 16, verses 4 through 15, but these things I have spoken to you so that when the hour comes, you may remember that I told you of them. These things I did not say to you at the beginning because I was with you. But now I am going to him who sent me, and none of you asks me, where are you going? But because I have said these things to you, sorrow has filled your heart. But I tell you the truth, it is to your advantage that I go away. For if I do not go away, the advocate will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. And he, when he comes, will convict the world concerning sin and righteousness and judgment, concerning sin because they do not believe in me, and concerning righteousness because I go to the Father and you no longer see me, and concerning judgment because the ruler of this world has been judged. I still have many more things to say to you, but you cannot bear them now. But when he, the Spirit of truth, comes, he will guide you into all the truth, for he will not speak from himself, but whatever he hears, and he will speak, and he will disclose to you what is to come. He will glorify me, for he will take of mine and will disclose it to you. All things that the Father has are mine. Therefore, I said that he takes of mine and will disclose it to you. Well, you can have a seat as we look into our time together. Just a few points in your bulletin if you'd like to follow along. The first, then, is the historical setting. And again, we're not going deep here. We're just going to touch all of these things. But today we have the pleasure to start our new Bible study, the book of Acts, which has been called the Acts of the Apostles. It's also been called the Acts of Jesus Christ, and it's also been called the Acts of the Holy Spirit, which is my preferred name. Luke was an evangelist, and he is the author of the Gospel of Luke. The book of Acts is called by many the fifth gospel. It would seem that Luke wrote both Acts and Luke at the same time, Luke first and then Acts second. Luke covers throughout the book the start and work of the early church. He speaks about the early Christians, their lives, and their work for the Lord, and it covers nearly three decades after the resurrection and ascension of our Lord Jesus Christ. The author is Luke, and when we compare the opening verses of Luke and Acts, you can hear and see that the same author wrote them both. In Luke chapter 1, verses 1 through 5, we read, "Inasmuch as many have undertaken to compile an account of the things that have been fulfilled among us, just as those who from the beginning were eyewitnesses and servants of the word handed them down to us." It seemed fitting for me as well, having investigated everything carefully from the beginning, to write it out for you in order an orderly sequence, most excellent Theophilus, so that you may know the certainty about the things you have been taught. In the days of Herod, king of Judah, there was a priest named Zechariah in the division of Abijah, and he had a wife from the daughters of Aaron, and her name was Elizabeth. And so we see here now in Acts chapter 1, our text, chapter 1, 1 through 5, the first account, O Theophilus, you see he's writing to the same person here. "I composed about all that Jesus began to do and teach," you'll find the same thing, "until the day when he was taken up to heaven after he had, by the Holy Spirit, given orders to the apostles whom he had chosen." In verse 3, "to whom he also presented himself alive after his suffering by many convincing proofs, appearing to them over 40 days and speaking about the things concerning the kingdom of God. And gathering them together, he commanded them not to leave Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise of the Father, which he said, you heard from me. For John baptized with water. You'll see they're both going, he's going into the same areas. But John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. So you can see he's writing to Theophilus. We'll get more into that as we get into our study as well. The church historically ascribed the writings of Acts to Luke as well. Luke was a beloved physician. We read about that in Colossians 4:14. And Luke, the beloved physician, sends you his greetings and also Demas. So he was a physician. So then the author is Luke, and he has included in his letter 28 chapters. Pretty lofty for us to enter this. Very difficult to teach this. It is constantly moving around, but it's wonderful. Being a new church, and that's what we consider ourselves, a new work. We're small, but we're mighty in the Lord, amen? It's a great book to study on the work of the blessed Holy Spirit through the preaching of the resurrection and the preaching of the gospel. We're going to see all kinds of things in the book, but 28 chapters. There are 19 sermons or formal addresses in this book. Many are from Paul, as you know. Several by Peter, and the longest is by Stephen, who was martyred. The book is first a firsthand look into the first century church, where the teaching of the gospel of Jesus Christ took precedent. Amen? Oh, that it would be that way today. The Holy Spirit is active through every page of the book of Acts. Now, Luke was an eyewitness to many of the events spoken of in the book as well as he investigated and he spoke with many people about the events. You will hear throughout the book of Acts about the work of faithful men who have been commissioned by Christ in the ministry of the Great Commission. That's exactly what you're seeing. It's picking up right where Christ left off. And as they go, they are spreading and preaching the gospel. And not only in Jerusalem, Judea, and Samaria, but to the outer ends of the earth, which at that time was Rome. We'll hear about that. So we understand that this gospel that they're preaching is the death, burial, and resurrection of our Lord. And we need to be faithful in our church to preach and live the Word of God. As we leave the church, we need to tell others as well. And it's going to show us what happens throughout the book. So throughout our study, you will hear that Luke accompanied Paul as well. And you'll see that in Acts 16:1. So setting sail from Taurus, you'll notice the word we ran a straight course to Samothrace. And on the day following Neapolis, Luke uses here the first person pronoun, the we in the text, and also in Acts chapters 20, 21, 27, and 28. Luke accompanied him. So again, it's not only information that was gathered, but it's firsthand information as well in the book of Acts. And we will look into this when we approach each scripture, by the way. One writer says, as with the other historical narratives in the Bible, Acts was written both to recount events and to impart theological truth. And that's really what I'm excited about. The book of Acts is the work of Jesus Christ by his Spirit in this fallen world. Jesus had spoken to his disciples as he walked with them on the way to the garden, and we just read the scripture as I opened up in John 16:4-15, and the Lord's instructing them. And we will hear about the works of the blessed Holy Spirit in the redemption of fallen sinners, amen? And this will be the theme of most important to the study of Acts. It's from page 1, you shall receive power, Jesus tells them, when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. And all the way to the end of the book, you're going to hear about the redemption. You're going to hear about the gospel and how it goes forth. The second point then, and I'm excited to arrive, and this is the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is God. He is the third person of the Trinity. In the 1689 London Baptist Confession, which we have the pleasure to study at this time in our Sunday school class with Ryan teaching it, says, in this divine and infinite being, there are three substances, the Father, the Word or Son, and the Holy Spirit of one substance, power, and eternity. Each having the whole divine essence, yet the essence undivided. Three in one, undivided. The Father is of none, neither begotten nor proceeding. The Son is eternally begotten of the Father, and the Holy Spirit proceeding from the Father and the Son, all infinite, without beginning. Therefore, but one God, who is not to be divided in nature and being, but distinguished by several peculiar relative properties and personal relations, which the doctrine of the Trinity is the foundation of all communication with God and dependence on Him. You cannot come to the Son without coming through the Father. The same would be if you have no belief at all in the Holy Spirit, then you have no part either. Of course, we know that the Father sent the Son, and then the Father and the Son sent the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit bears witness to every single thing that God sent the Son to do and everything that the Son said. And He points always not to Himself, but He points to the Father and the Son. And it's a wonderful thing. Beloved, after the ascension of our Lord and after the day of Pentecost, the apostles called the Holy Spirit the gift of God. Amen? I think you'll notice in my teachings and in my words that I very rarely say the Holy Spirit. I particularly always say the blessed Holy Spirit. And that was after hearing a message some years ago about the blessed Holy Spirit out of the Holy Spirit chapter there in Acts. Chapter 8, which speaks so much about the Lord. But I want to tell you today that this book of Acts has more to say about the work of the Holy Spirit, and it is going to encourage you. But Acts 20 says this, but Peter said to him, May your silver perish with you, because you supposed you could obtain the gift of God with money. You see? The gift of God. In Acts 10:45, and all the circumcised believers who came with Peter were astonished that the gift of the Holy Spirit, you see that? The gift of the Holy Spirit has been given by the Father and the Son to the church and to the individual that comes to Christ through faith. He is a gift from God. He is God. Amen? And we understand that. We will hear today that the Holy Spirit is Christ's gift to the church that makes up His blood-bought bride. That's the gift. It's all those that come to Christ. Jesus said in John 7:37, now on that last day, the great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried out saying, if anyone is thirsty, let him come to me and drink. The blessed Holy Spirit is working in redemption that our Savior secured on the cross of Calvary. He brings the believers into true spiritual union with Christ. Amen? Sounds like we're back in our class on the fundamentals of the faith. But boy, this is such a good message today. I'm so encouraged to bring it to you as well. The Holy Spirit, listen to me now, makes it possible for Jesus to be the source now of regeneration, justification, adoption, sanctification, glorification for those He redeems. It is the Spirit of God. In 1 Corinthians 1:30, we read, but by His doing, you are in Christ Jesus. By the Holy Spirit, you are in Christ Jesus. Amen? who became to us wisdom from God and righteousness and sanctification and redemption. The Holy Spirit works in conjunction with God the Son. Jesus had told his disciples in John 16 that we read earlier that when the Holy Spirit came, he would convict the world of sin. The Holy Spirit now, then, he convicts, he indwells, he justifies, he sanctifies, he adopts, he seals, and in the end will one day glorify us, all those whom Christ has died for. Well, the Holy Spirit is no less God than God the Father and God the Son. A shame on the church today that won't even worship the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is in charge of all things, beloved of the Lord. He's in charge of all things to the church as well. And we will see this throughout the study of Acts. Praise God and hallelujah. In the opening chapters of Acts, we will hear what our Lord was doing in his 40 days after his resurrection. This was after he purchased our salvation once and for all. However, his work did not end when he ascended into heaven. Luke's gospel ended with the ascension. I'm bringing you now into the thought here that Luke's gospel is called the fifth gospel. And so Luke's gospel ended with the ascension in Luke 24, 50 through 53. And he led them out as far as Bethany, and lifting his hands, he blessed them. And it happened that while he was blessing them, he parted from them and was carried up into heaven. And they, after worshiping him, returned to Jerusalem with great joy and were continually in the temple blessing God. Oh, hallelujah. We'll look into this more next time together. In this 40 days, we'll touch on for a moment this morning. In chapter 1, Luke speaks about the time before the ascension. And this is the 40 days before he ascends upward to his Father. And we will look into this in our first message next time, Lord willing. The date of the writing then, we believe is around 62 AD. And Luke tells us his purpose for writing in Luke 1:3. It seemed fitting for me as well, having investigated everything carefully from the beginning, to write it out for you in orderly sequence. Most excellent Theophilus. And as we know, he had a wider audience than that. He wrote to Theophilus, but he also wrote to the churches, and we're studying it shy of 2,000 years later. Amen? Now, Luke will take much time and care to tell how the early church grew through the witness of believers, beloved. The Great Commission is really a summary of what the whole book of Acts is about. It is the Great Commission being lived out in the lives of the believers. The key verse is in Acts 1:8, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be my witnesses both in Jerusalem and in all Judea, Samaria, and even to the end of the earth. He will tell us about the persecuted Christians throughout the book of Acts and how they were forced to scatter throughout the whole world. In Acts chapter 8, verse 1, now Saul, we've talked about this, was in hearty agreement with putting him to death, Stephen. And on that day, a great persecution began against the church in Jerusalem. And they were all scattered throughout the regions of Judea and Samaria, except for the apostles who were in Jerusalem. And if you're part of our study on Wednesday night, you'll understand that this, in our first few verses, is who James is writing to, those that have been scattered. Peter writes about those too. But beloved, what a wonderful book this is for us. Jerusalem now, they brought the gospel with them. So Luke will show us the progress of the church over 35 years throughout this study. as it spread from Jerusalem to Rome. And in this he will show how the early church grew as it was persecuted, as some left from Jerusalem. Beloved, they brought the gospel with them. Amen. If you leave this place and you go to another church, you're not going to leave the gospel behind. Doesn't matter why you're moving or what or how you're moving. You bring Christ with you everywhere you go. Amen? And we're going to see that. And we're going to also see much persecution. But over the next months, we will look into the Acts of Peter. You'll hear a lot. I say the Acts of the Apostles, the Acts of Jesus Christ, the Acts of the Holy Spirit. And now we mention the Acts of Peter and Paul. And there are only four apostles mentioned in the book of Acts, and that's Peter, Paul, James, and John. Beloved, in the early church, in the early chapters, verses 1 through 9, the book centers around Peter the apostle to the Jews. You know that. He preaches the first message in chapter 2. The latter chapters center on Paul, the apostle to the Gentiles. After Paul's conversion in chapter 9, Paul is very active in chapters 10 through 28. In fact, it's all about the ministry there. It's flavored with the Jerusalem Council and many other things, but for the most part, we're talking about Paul, his missionary journeys. We're talking about Paul escaping. We're talking about all kinds of things about Paul. Paul says this in Galatians 2:7, "But on the contrary, seeing that I had been entrusted with the gospel to the uncircumcised, just as Peter had been to the circumcised," both Jews and Gentiles. The book opens up with the Acts of Jesus Christ. So you hear I keep talking about the Acts of Jesus Christ. Luke says, "The Acts about all that Jesus began to do and teach until the day when he was taken up to heaven." We will hear that Acts is the Acts of faith of the apostles. There's another one. The Acts of faith of the apostles. And right away, we will hear about the boldness of the apostles and God's people in the face of persecution and even death. It started with the gift of the Holy Spirit that I mentioned earlier, as we read with the coming of the Holy Spirit in Acts 1:8, and you will hear this verse a lot. In Acts 1:8, I pray that you will bring it to memory and memorize it, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be my witnesses both in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and even to the end of the earth. Now, next week, we'll look at the reason why we needed that power. The apostles were transformed after the resurrection of our Lord as they went from a state of fear and denying, you remember that, and leaving Christ. They all fled. Peter denied him. They'll leave from that, and that might be the last picture, to such boldness that they had come, from the power of the Holy Spirit, this boldness that they had. And we will see their boldness, the boldness of the apostles, to stand before religious leaders and crowds who may have been the same ones who hung our Lord on the cross. The same persecution continues. We are in the same place as where we left. But you notice the difference, the boldness that has come upon them. And this boldness is the power of the Holy Spirit. They will preach Christ, his death, his resurrection, and his ascension. God will draw all those that he has ordained for salvation to come by faith to Jesus Christ as Lord through the gospel message. But Peter said in his first sermon in Acts chapter 2, verses 22 through 24, "Men of Israel, listen to these words. Jesus the Nazarene, a man attested to you by God with miracles and wonders and signs which God did through him in your midst, just as you yourselves know. This man, delivered over by the predetermined plan and foreknowledge of God, you nailed to a cross by the hands of lawless men and put him to death. Well, that kind of preaching will get you killed today. You see? But God raised him up again, putting an end to the agony of death, since it was impossible for him to be held in its power. They will also face the evil authorities, speaking of the apostles and disciples. They will face evil authorities throughout the book and even imprisonment for the gospel of Jesus Christ. And most of them, speaking of the apostles other than John, were martyred for Christ. In Acts chapter 4, 1 through 4, now as they were speaking to the people, the priest and the captain of the temple guard and the Sadducees came up to them, being greatly agitated because they were teaching the people and proclaiming in Jesus the resurrection from the dead. This is going to be the main theme throughout the book of Acts. And there's no power in any other name. And there's no power unless there's been a resurrection of that God-man, Jesus Christ. And they laid hands on them and put them in jail until the next day. For it was already evening, but many of those who had heard the message, oh, praise God, God opened their heart. You see it there? Believed. And the number of the men came to be about 5,000. You see the growth of the early church. We're just in chapter 4. With the preaching of the gospel, the preaching of the resurrected Lord. Oh, beloved of the Lord, we need apostolic preaching today. Also in Acts chapter 5, verse 17 through 23, but the high priest rose up, and those with him, that is the sect of the Sadducees, and they were filled with jealousy. And they laid hands on the apostles and put them in a public jail. But during the night, the angel of the Lord opened the door of the prison, taking them out. And he said, go, stand, and speak to the people in the temple the whole message of this life. Upon hearing this, they entered into the temple about daybreak and began to teach. And now when the high priest and those with him came, they called the Sanhedrin together, even all the council of the sons of Israel, the 70 of them, and sent, well, I don't know how many by now, they had to replace one or two, and sent orders to the jailhouse for them to be brought. But the officers who came did not find them in prison, and they returned and reported back, saying, we found the jailhouse locked quite surely, and the guards standing at the doors. But we opened it and found no one inside. None of the apostles, you know the story. But we will hear about many miracles performed that will attest the work of the apostles through the power of Jesus Christ and the blessed Holy Spirit. And this is the foundation and the formulation of the early church, that Christ had left his apostles, that Christ had given them certain gifts that would only be used during that time to attest that they had been with Jesus Christ and to give all glory to Jesus Christ. Today it would be so misused. I'm glad that the gifts have ceased. We will hear about many miracles performed that will attest the work of the apostles through the power of Jesus Christ and the blessed Holy Spirit. And that is where all power is. It is in God alone. And he is sovereign alone. And needs none of us to do what his plan is. He chooses to use us. And we will hear about Stephen in Acts chapter 6 and 7. And we have to say, what a man of God. And he knew what was coming. As Stephen loved the Lord and was obedient to the Lord, and we read in Acts 7, 54 through 60. Now when they heard this, they became furious. Now Stephen had given one of the best expositional messages that you want to read about, chapter 6 and 7 there. they became furious in their hearts, and this is when that happened after he preached. And they began gnashing their teeth at him. But being full, notice here, of the Holy Spirit for this particular event, he gazed intently into heaven and saw the glory of God. Oh, hallelujah. And Jesus standing at the right hand of God. And he said, "Behold, I see the heavens opened up, and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God." But crying out with a loud voice, they covered their ears. They couldn't even hear this. They covered such wickedness, and they rushed at him with one accord. And when they had driven him out of the city, they began stoning him. And the witnesses laid aside their garments at the feet of a young man named Saul. And they went on stoning Stephen as he was calling out and saying, "Lord Jesus, receive my spirit." Then falling on his knees, he cried out with a loud voice, "Lord, do not hold this sin against them." And having said this, he died. He fell asleep. Wow. Can't wait to get to this chapter. It's going to take us some time. We can say the Acts of the scattered church, which will come up quickly in our study, as we see here in chapter 7. We had talked a little earlier about the blessed Holy Spirit. And beloved, we're going to talk even more. I'm just so excited about this. I'd like to spend more time showing you an outline through the scripture in the book of Acts. I want to show you how many times the Spirit of God is mentioned and what he was doing. It's very important, the person and work of the Holy Spirit. I'd like to ask that you would follow along in scripture if you would. We have it in front of you, and if not, you can look at your copy of the Blessed Word of God. But let's start with our key verse there in Acts chapter 1, verse 8. "But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be my witnesses both in Jerusalem and in Judea and Samaria and even to the end of the earth." You see, the church would receive the power here. The disciples would receive the power. The apostles would receive this power. And it is a power that comes from the Holy Spirit. Notice the Holy Spirit was foretold in Acts chapter 1, verse 16. "Men, brothers, the scriptures had to be fulfilled, which the Holy Spirit foretold." Notice this. "Foretold by the mouth of David concerning Judas, who became a guide to those who arrested Jesus." You notice this? The Word of God has been written by the blessed Holy Spirit. Another promise, look, if you would, in Acts chapter 2, verse 4. "And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit was giving them utterance." Oh, this is known languages. Filled with the Holy Spirit is different than being baptized with the Holy Spirit. We will get into every one of these topics because it's important. But for a time here today, another promise then we saw there in Acts chapter 2, verse 4. We see boldness in the preaching by Peter. Notice in Acts 2, 32 through 34. "This Jesus God raised up again, to which we all are witnesses." Eyewitnesses. They've seen him alive. "Therefore, having been exalted to the right hand of God, and having received from the Father the promise of the Holy Spirit, he has poured out this which you both see and hear." This work that you are seeing, this prophecy that you are hearing, they're hearing the gospel in their own language. This is all the work of the blessed Holy Spirit. That's why Jesus said, "Go and wait for the coming of the blessed Holy Spirit, and you will receive power." We see boldness in that preaching of the Word of God. We see boldness in preaching. And we see this, therefore, having been exalted to the right hand of God. I love this. In Acts 2, 32 through 34, again, this Jesus God hath raised. Notice the witness, to which we are all witnesses. This is all about what we talked about earlier. Therefore, having been exalted after he ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father, the Spirit of God has poured out this, which you both see and hear. We'll get into all those details. The promise of the Holy Spirit for those who repent. Oh, what a beautiful verse Acts chapter 2, verse 38 is. And Peter said to them, repent, each one of you. Be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive, again, the gift of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is the gift from God. It is the gift of Christ to the church and to everyone that has been saved. Peter was filled with the Holy Spirit in Acts 4, verses 8 through 12. Then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, rulers and elders of the people, if we are being examined today for a good deed done to a sick man, as to how this man has been saved from his sickness, let it be known to all of you and to all the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus Christ, the Nazarene, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead, by this name, this man stands here before you in good health. Do you see all glory given to God? Not so today. The so-called miracle workers today are not going to give any glory to God. That won't bring any money in. Whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead, by this name, this man stands here before you in good health. He is the stone. Now, stay with me. He is the stone which was rejected by you, the builders, but which became the chief cornerstone. We know this scripture. And there is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven that has been given among men, men by which we must be saved. Notice already the life of these apostles. The boldness is incredible because the power of God has come upon them. That is the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. It's the same power that every single Christian that has been born again has as well today. And you'll hear the words. We should use the same words as well. And we should believe that God is a miracle-working God, as we talked about this morning. Amen? Ananias and Sapphira lied to the Holy Spirit in Acts chapter 5, verse 3. But Peter said, Ananias, why has Satan filled your heart to lie to the Holy Spirit and to keep back some of the price of the land? Wow. And again, this is a warning to the early church. And you'll remember the story that's set around it. Much fear went through the church. The Spirit of God knows exactly what's happening. We are told that the Holy Spirit himself is a witness to the gospel. And in fact, without the Holy Spirit, there is no gospel. The Holy Spirit and his ministry, we understand this. In Acts 5:32, and we are witnesses of these things, and so it is. The Holy Spirit, whom God gave to those who obey him. You see, the Spirit comes. He brings the message. We're convicted of our sin. We repent when we turn to our Savior. The Holy Spirit and his ministry in Acts chapter 6, verse 3. Therefore, brothers, select from among you seven men and of good reputation, full of the Spirit and of wisdom, whom we may put in charge of their need. We understand this. This is the chapter that many believe that this is the institution of the deacon. Stephen was full of the Holy Spirit in Acts chapter 6, verse 5. We've looked at a little of that later, but "and this word pleased the whole congregation." This is before that. "And they chose Stephen, a man full of faith," notice, "and of the Holy Spirit, and Philip, Prochorus, Nicanor, Timon, Parmenas, Nicholas, a proselyte from Antioch." Stephen said they had resisted the Holy Spirit in Acts chapter 7, verse 51. "You men, stiff-necked and uncircumcised," this is what got him into trouble as well. This is probably the way that that we need to preach the gospel as well. "You men, stiff-necked and uncircumcised in heart and ears, are always resisting the Holy Spirit. As your fathers did, so do you." You see, Stephen was full of the Holy Spirit in chapter 7, verse 55. "But being full of the Holy Spirit, he gazed intentionally into heaven and saw the glory of God and Jesus standing at the right hand of God." We read that earlier. Now, beloved, we're only on chapter 7. Do you see the work of the Holy Spirit? And we still have 21 more chapters. Lord willing, we'll get there. The Samaritan believers, who were half Jews and half Gentiles, received the Holy Spirit as well in Acts chapter 8, verse 14 and 15. "Now when the apostles in Jerusalem heard that Samaria had received the word of God, they sent them Peter and John," in verse 15, "who came down and prayed for them that they might receive the Holy Spirit." We'll talk about that as well. Paul was filled with the Holy Spirit in Acts 9, 17. "So Ananias departed and entered the house." This is after Paul's conversion. "And he laid his hands on him and he said, 'Brother Saul, the Lord sent me,'" that is Jesus, "'who appeared to you on the road by which you were coming, so that you may regain your sight and be filled with the Holy Spirit.'" The testimony of Peter, that Jesus was anointed now with the Holy Spirit. Peter talks about this in Acts 10:38. He says this, "You know of Jesus of Nazareth, how God anointed him with the Holy Spirit and with power, and how he went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him." We'll get into that. That's a good study. The Gentiles received the Holy Spirit, and if you're a Gentile here today and not a Jew, praise God that salvation is for us as well. Amen. The Gentiles received the Holy Spirit in Acts 10:47. You remember the scripture, "Can anyone refuse water for these to be baptized who have received the Holy Spirit just as we did?" And this will be part of the Jerusalem Council as well, a little later in chapter 15. Peter gives his report in Jerusalem, different than that one, in Acts 11:12. In Acts 11:12, "And the Spirit told me," look at who's in charge now. Look at what the Spirit of God is doing. Peter, "And the Spirit told me to go with them without taking issue at all. Those six brothers also went with me, and we entered the man's house." Wow. The Spirit told him where to go. Barnabas was a man full of the Holy Spirit in Acts chapter 11, verse 24. "Oh, he was a good man and full of the Holy Spirit and of faith, and a considerable crowd was brought to the Lord." And the gift of Barnabas earlier is what got Ananias and Sapphira into some trouble. We'll get into some detail there as we get into our studies. But the blessed Holy Spirit is in charge of missions. In Acts 13:2, "And while they were ministering to the Lord and fasting, the Holy Spirit said, 'Separate for me Barnabas and Saul for the work to which I have called them.'" This is the first missionary journey of Paul here. You see, the Spirit of God is the one that calls missionaries into the mission field. as he did here. The blessed Holy Spirit sent them on their mission in Acts 13:4, just a few verses after that. So being sent out by the Holy Spirit, they went down to Seleucia, and from there they sailed to Cyprus. You seeing the work of the Holy Spirit is amazing, isn't he? And he's still doing the same work today, by the way. It's just got different names, different church names, different people. Paul was filled with the Holy Spirit in Acts 13, verses 8 through 12. But Almas the magician, for so his name is translated, was opposing them, seeking to turn the proconsul away from the faith. But Saul, who was also known as Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, fixed his gaze on him and said, "You who are full of all deceit and fraud, you son of the devil, you enemy of all righteousness, will you not cease to make crooked the straight ways of the Lord? Now behold, the hand of the Lord is upon you, and you will be blind and not see the sun for a time." And immediately a mist and darkness fell upon him, and he went about seeking those who would lead him by the hand. Then proconsul believed when he saw what had happened, being astonished. Notice, of Peter. No, of the Lord. You see it? And that's what a true ministry does. A true ministry is empowered by the Holy Spirit with the blessed word of God, and then the man of God, the woman of God, is then filled with the Holy Spirit to go forth and to speak the words of God. Amen? It's the same today as it was then. The disciples were filled with the Holy Spirit. In Acts 13:52, and the disciples were continually filled with the joy. Notice the word joy as well, and with the Holy Spirit. We should be the most joyful people that God has come to reside within us, the blessed Holy Spirit. Peter recalls the work of the Holy Spirit. Now we are in the Jerusalem Council. Peter recalls the work of the Holy Spirit before the Jerusalem Council in Acts 15:8. Listen to the scripture. "And God, who knows the heart, testified to them, giving them the Holy Spirit, just as he did also to us." How blessed that is. He had to defend that. Well, I didn't like that. Some Jews want to hang on to that, but not so much. God is the God of both the Jews and the Gentiles. He is a God of all those that seek him by faith. A church leaders in Acts 15:28, you'll notice, this is a verse that's very familiar with the men. "For it seemed good to the Holy Spirit and to us to lay upon you no greater burden than these essentials." You'll remember in the Jerusalem Council, which we'll go through in some detail, they had come up with the things that the Gentile believers should do. Don't eat things with blood. It's not going to save you, but just don't do that. And some other things. We'll go through that in the scripture. But it is certainly not what Paul is arguing against in the book of Galatians, where they believe that you come to Christ through the ceremonies and you come to Christ in other ways. Oh, no, no. You come to Christ, period. Paul was forbidden in Acts 16. Notice this. In 16:6-7, "And they passed through Phrygian and Galatian region, having been forbidden," notice the words, "by the Holy Spirit to speak the word in Asia." Notice that. The Spirit of God forbid them to preach the gospel in Asia at that time, at that moment. And after they came to Malaysia, they were trying to go to Bethania, and the Spirit of Jesus did not permit them. Now, the Spirit of Jesus is the Holy Spirit. Amen? The Spirit of God is the Holy Spirit. Amen? Let's keep that in our minds, because What happens is we have so many people teaching all kinds of doctrines of demons out there. Wow, we're moving along. The Ephesian believers in Acts chapter 19, verse 6. And when Paul laid his hands upon them, the Holy Spirit came on them, and they began speaking with tongues and prophesying. They began speaking in known languages and preaching the gospel of the cross, the death, burial, and resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. The Holy Spirit informs. Paul informs Paul in Acts 20:23, except that the Holy Spirit solemnly testify to me in every city, saying that chains and afflictions await me. The Spirit of God prepared him for Paul for what was going to befall him. You'll hear some others here, and you'll see the way the Scripture is written is so awesome. The blessed Holy Spirit in Acts 20:28, and this is a very familiar verse, because this is actually where the elders today and the elders in this church have such boldness. We're warned first, be on guard for yourselves, for all the flock among which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers. You see, the Spirit of God is the one that calls elders to the position of elders. The church recognizes it. Now in Timothy chapter 3 and in Titus, we have the qualifications. And those qualifications tell us how the elder and even the deacon later on in Timothy, how and what we need to look like. But first and foremost, the call comes from above. It's the same thing with salvation. And God is the one that calls the elders. That's why when you're called, you can never walk away. This is a lifetime calling. That's why Constitution shouldn't say that an elder should be only an elder for 2 years. I am an elder for life. God gifted me at salvation, the gift of being an elder. Now, I will say this. Through the preaching and teaching of the Word of God, you recognize the gift that has been given to your elders, Orion and David and I. You recognize the hand of God upon us. Oh, beloved, if we don't speak the words of Christ, well, what are we doing? But notice this, very important eldership. Be on guard for yourselves. Watch your life, elder. And for all the flock, watch God's blood-bought bride. Whether there's 1 or 100 or 1,000, among which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers, to shepherd the church of God, which he purchased with his blood. This verse makes us tremble as elders. We tremble at this verse, and we should. The blessed Holy Spirit in Acts 21:11, and coming to us, he took Paul's belt and bound his own feet and hands and said, this is what the Holy Spirit says. Wow, that's boldness, isn't it? This cannot happen today, by the way. The Holy Spirit can lead us. He can make us uncomfortable about some lifestyle sins. Let's just call it what it is, not mistakes. He will grieve us as we grieve him as well. But notice here, this is what the Holy Spirit says. This is a prophet of God speaking to Paul, trying to convince him. We'll get into the scripture. Trying to convince him not to go to Rome. When I just read to you earlier that he's already been told by the Spirit of God what's going to befall him. He knows already how he's going to die, just like Peter did. The Lord told him as well. This is what the Holy Spirit says. In this way, the Jews at Jerusalem will bind the man who owns this belt and deliver him into the hands of the Gentiles. That's exactly what happened. But he said it. He might have stepped over his bounds. He took it to the next level. Paul was going to Rome. So Paul's then ministry in Rome, and we're entering now Acts 28:8. So, in other words, I could say in closing, but unfortunately there's still more time. And it happened that after 3 days, Paul called together those who were the leading men of the Jews, and when they came together, he began saying to them, "Brothers, though I had done nothing against our people or the customs of our fathers, yet I was delivered as a prisoner from Jerusalem into the hands of the Romans." Now, down a little bit, some scripture here for us, but you can pick out scripture, but I'd rather just read it to you because we're not accustomed to the story quite yet. In Acts 28, 18 through 30, now you get your ears open for what the Holy Spirit says here. "And when they had examined me," Paul says, "they were willing to release me because there was no ground for putting me to death. But when the Jews objected, I was forced to appeal to Caesar, not that I had any accusation against my nation. For this reason, therefore, I requested to see you and to speak with you. For I am wearing this chain for the sake of the hope of Israel." Notice those words. "And they said to him, 'We have neither received letters from Judea concerning you, nor have any of the brothers come here and reported or spoken against bad about you. But we desire to hear from you what you think. For concerning this sect, it is known to us that it is spoken against everywhere.'" Oh, beloved, this is Jesus Christ and the resurrection and the gospel. "And when they set a day for Paul, they came to him, and at his lodging in large numbers, and he was explaining to them by solemnly bearing witness about the kingdom of God and trying to persuade them concerning Jesus from both the law of Moses and from the prophets from morning until evening." I say he was pretty persistent, amen? "And some were," well, look at that, "were being persuaded by the things spoken, but others were not believing." Look at verse 25 then. "And when they disagreed with one another," the ones that believed and the ones that didn't, "they began leaving after Paul had spoken one word. And the Holy Spirit rightly spoke through Isaiah the prophet to your fathers." Look at verse 26. And Jesus spoke about this verse. And this verse also sits in Isaiah chapter 6. After holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. In 26 saying, "Go to this people and say, 'You will keep on hearing, but you will not understand. You will keep on seeing, but you will not perceive. You will not see. For the heart of this people has become dull, and with their ears they scarcely hear, and they have closed their eyes, lest they might see with their eyes, and hear with their ears, and understand with their hearts, and return, and I will heal them. Therefore, let it be known to you that the salvation of God was sent to the Gentiles, and they will also hear.' And when he had spoken these words, the Jews departed, having a great dispute among themselves. And he stayed 2 full years in his own rented quarters and was welcoming all who came to him, preaching the kingdom of God and teaching concerning the Lord Jesus Christ with all confidence unhinged or unhindered." Beloved, do you see, and I've left out a few, how many times your blessed God, the blessed Holy Spirit, is spoken of in the book of Acts? Have you ever noticed that before? Probably not. But you'll always notice it now, amen? In his book, The Pursuit of God, A.W. Tozer says, We started speaking about the Holy Trinity, and we'll end with that as well. The Holy Trinity is one God, for we worship one God in Trinity and unity, neither confounding the persons nor dividing the substance. For there is one person of the Father, another of the Son, and another of the Holy Ghost. But the Godhead of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost is all one. The glory equal and the majesty co-eternal. So in part run the ancient creed, and so the inspired word declares. Praise God. Beloved, we will learn a lot more about the person and work of the blessed Holy Spirit throughout our study. And today we learn that the work of the Holy Spirit in this age began at Pentecost. This would be the dispensation, if you want to throw that word out and get people twisted, which is just another time. In different times, we had, of course, Israel who failed, and now we have the church. And so this is the church age. That would be a different dispensation. Anyways, today we learn that the work of the Holy Spirit in this age began at Pentecost. He was sent by the Father and the Son as promised by Christ in John chapter 14, verse 16 through 17. Those are the scriptures we read in the beginning. He came to initiate and complete the building of the body of Christ, which is Christ's church. And today, I want to just say how exciting it was to hear afresh that the Holy Spirit convicts the world of sin and righteousness and judgment. Oh, beloved of the Lord, without that, no one can be saved. The Lord Jesus Christ and transforms believers into the image of Christ. Let me reread that. He glorifies the Lord Jesus Christ and transforms believers into the image of Christ. Paul says it this way in one of your favorite verses. In Romans 8:29, because those he foreknew, he also predestined to become conformed to the image of his Son, so that he would be the firstborn among many brothers. Oh, beloved, what a lesson on the acts of the blessed Holy Spirit that we have been privileged to look into today. I pray this opens your eyes and that you will study more, and we will break it all down. It will take us some time to get through 28 chapters, just like it did with the book of Matthew. And I went fairly fast, considered by most. Martin Lloyd-Jones, I think he took 10, 12 years. And rightfully so, that man is such a deep well. My well is not anywhere near that well, but I am studying. Now, that man could draw things out. What a man of God who's given glory today in heaven to the Father, Son, and blessed Holy Spirit. Let us give all glory to God. Oh, Father, you have been so faithful again. Oh, Father, as we just look through this glorious book, this fifth gospel, oh, Father, it is just full of the work of the blessed Holy Spirit. And, Father, we have just been so filled with understanding, with illumination. Thank you, blessed Holy Spirit. We'd ask that you continue to teach us, remind us who is in charge. Remind us that the Spirit of God has been sent. Thank you, Father and Son, for sending him. Thank you, Holy Father. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, blessed Holy Spirit. We just ask now that we would submit to you, that we, after receiving power, the day that we were saved, that we would go and tell someone this day. Father, burn it into our hearts. Give us opportunities. And we'll give you all the praise and all the glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
right, let's stand. Get to close with the Lord as our salvation. Ooh, ooh. Thank goodness.
The grace of God has reached for me. Pulled me from the raging sea, and I am safe on the solid ground. The Lord is my salvation. I will not fear when darkness falls. His strength will help me scale these walls. I see the dawn of the rising sun. The Lord is my salvation. Who is like the Lord our God? Strong to save, faithful in love. My debt is paid and the victory won. The Lord is my salvation. My hope is hidden in the Lord. He fulfills each promise of his word.
When winter fades and our spring will come, the Lord is my salvation. In times of waiting, times of need, when I'm no loss, when I am weak, I know his grace will renew these days. The Lord is my salvation.
Who is like the Lord our God? Strong to save, faithful in love. My debt is paid and the victory won. The Lord is my salvation. And when I reach my final day, he will not leave me in the grave.
Thank you, Lord.
But I will rise. He will call me home. The Lord is my salvation.
Who is like the Lord our God? Strong to save, faithful in love. My debt is paid and the victory won. The Lord is my salvation. Glory be to God the Father. Glory be to God the Son. Glory be to God the Spirit.
There's the Trinity.
The Lord is our salvation. Glory be to God the Father. Glory be to God the Son. Glory be to God the Spirit. The Lord is our salvation. The Lord is our salvation. The Lord is our salvation.
Amen. Amen. Woo.
Amen indeed. Our benediction this week is from 1 Timothy. He who is blessed and only sovereign, the King of kings and the Lord of lords, who alone has immortality and dwells in unapproachable light, whom no man has seen or can see, to him be honor and eternal might. Amen. God bless. Make it a great week.